Okay, good afternoon, everyone. And this is our special session entitled Dynamical Systems to Model and Control Epidemic Spreading, COVID-19 and Beyond. I really appreciate your participation and I really love the fact that our community tackled this endeavor immediately after the initial outbreak of COVID-19, trying to provide answers, especially on the fields of modeling and control of the epidemic. That is what actually we are supposed to do in our field. Many of us, if not everyone, already met in a meeting of the Control System Society of the IEEE organized by Fabrizio Da Bene a couple of months ago. And I really love to see everyone again for an update on your research on these horrible events that has taken away something like 900,000 of lives worldwide. So without further ado, I recommend to stick on the schedule. You have 15 minutes for plus five of questions. And I leave the floor to the first speaker, Corrado Possieri, that presents a work entitled A Time-Varying SIRD Model for the COVID-19 Contagion in Italy.
Thank you, Alessandro, for the presentation. Let me start sharing. Okay. You see everything, right? Yeah. So I am Corrado Possieri. I am a researcher from the National Research Council of Italy, and this is a joint work with Giuseppe Calafiore and Carlo Novara from the Politecnico di Torino. And our objective was to find a model for the COVID contagion in Italy. And this work started right at the beginning when we were locked down, and then we continued trying to refine our model, and we'll see how we progress it during time. And essentially we started with a modified SIR model, adding a compartment for the citizen people. Then we show how to identify this model from the data that are available from our government. Firstly, considering constant parameters, and then considering time parameters. So what we did is to use a simple SIR model. So we assume that we are considering a certain region that we assume to be isolated from the others. And inside this region, we identify four compartments of individuals. The first compartment is the one of susceptible individuals. The second is by eye are the ones that are infected. Then there is a compartment for recovered people, people that went through the disease and actually survived and is starting recovering. And then this, unfortunately, deceased people. And here time is a discrete time. And since we have data that are available on daily basis, we assume that the increment of time is essentially one day. We started by trying to construct a model. And so we started by considering the average number of contacts that people have during a day. And we let I or iota be the probability of contagion. And essentially we ended up considering this quantity of new individuals that each day enters in the infected compartment. Essentially people that were before the day before were good, and then the day after they become develop the illness. And essentially this beta here is what we denote as transmission rate, and incorporates both the average number of contacts that each people has during each day and the probability of contagion. We have also two other parameters that are essentially the recovery rate and the death rate. So what we can do is to define a model that is a discrete time model that describes the evolution of people that goes in and out of each compartment. Essentially, you cannot go out from the recovered and diseased compartment, but people essentially flow from the susceptible to the infective, and that are the ones that are actually spreading the disease. And then once you are infective, you can go either to recover the disease. And the model is initialized at some time T0, that is essentially the first day where we have data, starting from some initial conditions. That some of them are known, some of them are not. Actually, what we can do is not to measure the actual quantities, since just a portion of the infected individual, a portion of recovered individual, and a portion of diseased individuals are actually measured. And so what we did is to firstly modify the model, introducing an unknown parameter that we denote by alpha. This is essentially the ratio of people that are actually diagnosed. And so we assume, and it is a rather strong assumption, but it was made just to keep things simple. And essentially we assume that the same ratio of infected, recovered, and deceased individual is detected. So we assume that this parameter is the same for all the three compartments. And we defined an auxiliary variable S tilde, using this parameter that essentially denote the fraction of people that are diagnosed. And doing this, we can rewrite the model in the new coordinates that are the one that with the over tilde. And as you can see, the model in these quantities is essentially the same, is identical to the original one. The only difference is that we have different initial conditions, essentially, and in particular, letting pop be the total number of people that are in the region of interest. We have that S tilde 0 is equal to this quantity here, where Q is an unknown parameter that has to be identified, as well as the parameters beta, gamma, and nu. So let's start with the first attempt to identify a model, to identify the parameters for this model. What we have at each time instant is measurements of these three quantities. Essentially, we can measure the detected number of infected individuals, the detected number of recovered individuals, and the detected number of deceased individuals. What we don't know is the initial condition of the susceptible compartment that, remember, since we did a change of variables, is not the same. Essentially, this is related to the actual fraction of people that can be infected and of the detection rate. And then we have also identified the parameter gamma, beta, and nu that essentially encode the dynamics of our model. What we did is to use a regression form. So essentially, if we define the difference vector in this way, that is the value on next day minus the value at the current day, we have that the model can be expressed in this way here. And so by denoting phi of t a q, note that this depends on q, since s tilde depends on q, we have a model that is in regression form. As you can see, it's a sort of linear regression in the parameters theta, but is non-linear in the parameter q. And so we can define the increment as a non-linear function of q times theta, where theta is the vector of our parameters. So if we define essentially a mean square error that is with a weighting factor W, so to account more for last days rather than the older data, we end up with solving an optimization problem as the form that is written here. Our objective is to minimize this mean square error using the parameters Q and theta, with theta that has to be greater or equal to zero in order to make sense, and Q has to be between zero and one. And then there is also a minimum value of Q that is essentially the ratio of total people that have been involved within the epidemics over the total number of population. What we noted is that if we fix Q, this is essentially a constant matrix. I mean, this is time varying, but once you did all the computation, these are just constant. And so the problem is a linear problem and linear optimization problem, a linear constraint optimization problem, and so can be solved easily if Q is fixed. On the other hand, the dependency of F on Q is not linear and so is more involved. So what we did is to grid over the possible values of Q that we know that has to lie between Q min and one. And then for each of these Q, we solve a constrained least square problem that can be solved easily by classical convex optimization techniques. And then we retain the QE that yield to the minimum value of the function F, And so what we have is that using just a gridding approach over the variables wherein the problem is non-convex, we can end up obtaining obtaining a solution to the original problem. And this is actually one of the results that we get. And the data that I've been using to train the model are the one between the magenta line and the green line. And the others are the actual data that we received afterwards and the prediction that is multi-simulation prediction. I don't want to spend time on this, but essentially is a simulation approach that accounts more for days for newer data than for older data. And as you can see here, if we end up our training just before the 3rd of April, so at the end of March, we have that the curves are actually much higher than the ones that we actually had afterwards. And this is essentially due to the fact that during this period, there are some containment measurements that have been accounted, like social distancing, lockdown, use of masks, and so on. And so probably what we are seeing here, the integral of the difference between this curve are essentially the number of infected people that have been gathered, social amount of the effects, essentially, of the quarantine of the measurements that have been done. But what we wanted to do is to obtain a model that fits for the largest time possible, and so we needed to account for time-varying parameters. And this is essentially due to the fact that the things have changed during time, because new kind of drugs have been discovered, new kind of treatments, and also the social distancing protocol is more and more effective. And so we accounted for time varying parameters, and to do so, we used some basic time profiles. These were essentially exponential function and sigmoid-like functions. And what we wanted to do in this case is not to just estimate one single parameters, but the coefficients of these functions. And so again, what we can do is to rewrite the model in regression form. So by using some using this basis function b1, bn, g1, gm, and m1, mn, what we did is to redefine all the problem accounting for these functions. Now, the fact is that this model has a very large number of parameters, since we can account for a very large number of basis functions in order to make it as general as possible. So what we did is to use, rather than a mean square approach, an approach that is based on lasso. This essentially means to add an additional term here that is lambda, there is a sparsity weight, and to add a cost on the one norm of the vector theta of parameters that we have to estimate. And in this way, by increasing lambda, we increase the sparsity of the solution. So we retain the minimum number of actual variables that are of interest. And this is another simulation. We use a slightly larger period, but as you can see, in this way, we are able to actually fit the actual values of infected, recovered, and diseased people that we noticed through the data that were released from the Dipartimento di Protezione Civile. So what we did next is to consider also regional data. So we accounted for the red regions that were most affected by COVID-19. And in particular, as you can see, we consider Lombardia, Piemonte, Emilia Romagna, and Veneto. And even in this case where there are less data and maybe the data are less reliable and there are less number than the ones that we gathered for the national case, we got good performance, good fitting performance, even in the outside sample. What is next to do is, as you may have noticed in this slide, we ended up our analysis, our comparison between simulated and actual data on the 22nd of June. And this is because the paper was actually submitted on that day. But what we want to do next is to consider now the fact that the curve is not monotonic. So if you see the curve now, there is a little bump here. And also to account for this bump, we have to use different kind of basis function, essentially shifted basis function, and to see what's going on and to understand the phenomenon that is happening in these days. So this ends up my presentation, and thank you for your attention.
Sorry, thank you, Corrado. Very interesting. There are a couple of questions. So the first question is from Sauro Longhi.
I cannot see the... let me try to see if there is a way to get the... So yeah, go on with the... Because I cannot see the question and answer.
No. They don't write. They speak. Sauro, do you have a question? Maybe Sauro is not listening. I move forward and then I go back to Sauro. Patrizio.
Yes, can I share the video? Okay, ciao Corrado.
Buongiorno.
Ciao.
I have to stop sharing. Okay, here it is.
No, it's okay. Okay, a couple of curiosities. So the first one is in the minimization for least square. You have to assume that the parameters are positive, so it's a constraint minimization, right?
Because it's a constraint minimization.
So this, okay, so convexity is still true, or I mean?
Yeah, absolutely, because essentially you are in the positive octant, right? And the positive octant is a convex set, and since the objective is convex, you can simply
You're using f-min-con or other?
We are using f-min-con. Essentially, gradient descent is guaranteed to converge to the actual optimum.
Okay, this was the first. The second, very quick, is for prediction for time-varying parameters, because I tried many times to work out an extended Kalman filter, so you have time-varying parameters, right? But then you cannot, let's say, extend the time window after the data, because parameters are not still. So since I've seen that you have extended for a few weeks.
Absolutely, yes. This is because we didn't actually estimate the parameters time by time, but we estimated some functional forms of the parameters. Essentially, we use basis function, and then we are estimating the...
So you can prolong them after the end of the data, let's say.
Absolutely, yes. Because we are estimating function. We are estimating the coefficients of our function.
Yeah. You have basis, BI, and so on. Thank you.
Thank you, Patrizio. I have Sauro, maybe, that wants to speak.
Sauro disappears.
Maybe disappeared. Luca Patanè.
Hi, thank you for the nice presentation. Did you think about the possibility to introduce another transition between population R and S, for instance, introducing some refractory period just to verify the problem of absence of immunity?
Absolutely. I mean, this was made with the aim of keeping the model as simple as possible. You can even consider introducing an exposed, for instance, compartment that accounts for the people that have exposed to the virus but are not yet infected. So to consider the delay between, for instance, the fact that you are infected by the virus but you show symptoms or you start infecting other people. And this is surely something to account for, but the goal here was to keep the model as simple as possible. So we use the bare minimum number of parameters, the bare minimum number of compartments.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I think, I don't know, maybe Sauro doesn't want to ask a question anymore, and it's time, maybe we can keep this for offline conversation. It's time to move forward to the next presenter. So the work is intermittent yet coordinated regional strategies can alleviate the COVID-19 epidemic, a network model of the Italian case. There are a lot of authors. I cite Fabio Della Rossa and others. So Fabio, I think Fabio is presenting. So Fabio, whenever you want to start, the floor is yours.
So I was looking for where the things, the audio switch was. Okay, you should see and hear me, is correct?
Yeah, I see your screen, yeah.
Oh, and you see also me, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Thank you to give me the opportunity to present here. And as you anticipated, I present a work that I did in collaboration with the group of control in Naples and some friends from Salerno and from Enea. So the idea what I will present is this COVID-19 model in which we focus on regional differences that are typical in the Italian situation, because regionalism is part of the Italian constitution and each region is in charge of is part of the national health system. And at the end, each region is also a controller. The national rules are given, but each region has modified them with various regional decree. Obviously, if you take an aggregate model, national model, you cannot take into account this peculiarity. And so what we have done is look to a network model in which each of the 20 regions is a node, and the link between each node model the interregional fluxes. And with this model, we try to answer to different questions. The two more important that I report here is understand from the data the effect of the measures that have been taken from the Italian government, and more interesting, try to design and evaluate some region-specific intervention strategy. So let's start with the model for each region. Obviously we used a modified SIR model in which we have the susceptible, the infected, the quarantine, the hospitalized, the death, and the recovered. We decided to use this model with these compartments because we have found with several trials in several identification trials that was the easiest model that was able to represent and fit the data. In fact, as you know, and as also Corrado already said, the data given by the Protezione Civile are the number of quarantine, the number of hospitalized, the number of death, and the number of recovered people from hospitalization. And so these compartments must be present in the model or in some exit of the model in order to make the fitting. Then, since not all the parameters are easily to be identified or identifiable, for example, for the transmission rate, you see, we use two parameters, rho and beta, where beta is effectively the infection rate, the probability of infection, while rho is a parameter that we introduce in order to model social distancing. And so they, in the model, in the SIR model, they are in product. So you cannot identify the value of only of rho, of only of beta, if you don't fix, for example, the value of beta that we fixed at 0.4. And another parameter that we fixed is the rate from which infectious people recover without requiring hospitalization or quarantine, so without getting notified by the Italian government and the Protezione Civile, since this rate also is not unidentifiable like before, but it's very hard to be identified because it links to compartments that are non-directly measurable. Obviously, as the previous presentation highlighted, if you want to have a good model, we need that parameters change in time. And our assumption is that parameters are constant over time intervals. We did not make a continuous time evolution, but just keep them constant. Under this assumption, we have proposed an algorithm that is able to find the parameter values, and not only the parameter values, but also when the parameter values have changed looking at the data. I'll try to present the identification methodology with a cartoon. The first thing that we did is introduce the total number of impacted people. We introduced them because in this way we have split the model in two parts. The first part is composed by this three nonlinear ordinary differential equation, and using the data of the Protezione Civile, we made an ad hoc identification algorithm that briefly it identifies in a similar way as the one presented by Corrado in the previous talk, the parameters into many sub-interval of the data, and then make a statistical test to verify if there is a significant parameter change in this sub-interval. In this way, from this first part of the model, we identify the first set of parameters that are rho I, that is the effect of the social distancing, tau, that is the rate at which an infected is discovered, the historical series of the infected, and the length of the time interval in which parameters rho, tau, rho, and tau can be considered constant. Then this information is passed to the second set of equations, and again using the available data, and this time using a standard least square identification. If you want, with constraints, but effectively, we always tried to not hit the constraint of positivity for the parameters. And when we hit the constraint of positivity of the parameters, so we have tried to understand why it happens. And so we have tried to or change the model, and this is why in the previous slide, I said that the model was data-driven, and or to filter the data in order to avoid the constraints to be hit. By the way, in this way, we obtain the estimate for all the other parameters in each window. This procedure has been applied to all the 20 regions. And of course, we played also at the national level, and this is the result. You get clearly the fitting, and you see that at a certain point, the parameter changes, and the parameter change is automatically detected by our identification algorithm. And those are the parameters that we have found. And as you can see, the social distancing parameter that was one, almost one, at the beginning of the end of February, the beginning of the epidemic, has decreased and dropped to 0.3. confirming in some way the effectiveness of the national lockdown measure. As I said, the thing that we want to do is use this model to predict the epidemic curve and to make some control. So we have also tried, as also Corrado did, the capability of predict the prediction capability of our model, and effectively we are almost proud of what we obtained, because you see here at the end of March, with using 10 days, only 10 days to fit the model, we were able to understand the epidemic curve up to the beginning of May with an error that was less than 3%. And so was, this is at the national level, and so was also for infected, death, and quarantined. Thus, this can be a point in favor to the fact that effectively is not a bad answer as the one we took of think the parameters as constant on time window. Before going into the model per se, I want to show you some other evidences from the data. I take the example of my region, Lombardy, and as I said before, it is possible to see the subsequent decrease of the product Robita, and the dates that we have found are compatible with the decrease that were declared during that time. You see here at the 2nd of March, we have the first significant decrease of this parameter, and it can be a consequence of the declaration of the red zone. And on the 20th of March, we have another...
2 minutes.
2 minutes. Oops.
Yeah, because if there are no questions, you can take the question time, but then I have to cut the questions.
Sorry.
No problem.
Okay. After we have also estimated the fluxes, and we estimated them from some data repositories, from different data repositories, and here is the model, the complete model, that national model. The key features are exactly, you see that apart there is this phi that represents the fraction of people of region I that is in region J, and you see that through this phi, people in different regions can meet the other. And another important thing that we put is explicit dependence of the mortality rate from the hospital saturation. We also estimated the cost in order to give attach some number to each of our simulation when we say that there is a lockdown, and also in this case we already know that the regional differences count a lot. And we propose a feedback control over in which to reduce mortality, we avoid hospital saturation, and so we adopt lockdown measures when the regional health system is above a certain threshold, and we release the lockdown measures when we drop below another threshold. Here is the main result that gave also the title of my presentation, that is intermittent yet coordinate regional strategies can alleviate the COVID-19 pandemic. You see in each of the panel reported in magenta the number of current infected people, in blue the number of hospitalized, and in red the saturation of the hospital capacity. And the panel background is red when lockdown measures are enforced, and green when lockdown measures are not enforced. And as you can see, if we apply our control rule at a national level, we obtain this panel, and you see that lockdown is not enforced in very short period. While if we work with the same control rule at regional level, we have many regions that are mostly open. And the most interesting thing that gave us, let us to say that it can alleviate, is that actually, if you act regionally and not nationally, it is possible to have at the same time less cases, less deaths, less hospitalized people, and also lower economic cost for the COVID-19 epidemic. This is the main message, and this was just to recap what I said. And an interesting thing is that at the end of April, Giuseppe Conte said that we need some differentiated but coordinated strategy. We agree about that. Let's hope that we do also that in the future. I thank you that you have listened to me, and I thank all the collaborators for this very nice project. I finished.
Thank you, Fabio, for the interesting presentation. Are there any questions from the audience? We have 3 minutes. I'll go for a quick one. When you say, okay, Mauro Franceschelli, go ahead.
Hi, I was just wondering, so you choose a very particular graph structure for the network model, so where it's basically a proximity graph, right?
For Italy, you mean?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, so I was wondering, because so as we have seen recently, so the flow of people, especially tourists, has a great influence in the dynamics of a pandemic. So I was wondering, could simply using maybe a complete but weighted graph improve the model? Or why using a proximity graph? For what's the advantage or disadvantage?
So we have chosen to use the proximity graphs because we started, as you have seen in the data, this work during the lockdown, in which Italy was excluded from tourism and other situations like that, and just proximity flows were present. Effectively, it's not said that people cannot move. So you see, we have also added some long distance route in order to try to capture what you have said. The discretization that we have, that is more or less one day, we don't feel that it is so easy to directly go even from Sicily to Val d'Aosta, even if it is obviously possible. Maybe.
Sorry, I have to ask you to wrap up because we have strict constraints on time. So I think maybe you can wrap up, Fabio, and then you can keep the following on the conversation for offline. Do you want to make a conclusion very quick so we can introduce the next speaker?
No, I was saying that maybe for sure a weighted graph can help, but it's very hard to be estimate.
Okay, and thank you.
Thank you very much. Sorry to be so harsh, but actually we have to stay on time because of the next round table. So that's why I'm being so picky on timing. So next talk, thank you Fabio again. Thank you Mauro for the question. Next talk is work by Paolo Di Gianberardino and Daniela Iacoviello, ex post analysis of the counteractions against COVID-19, the Italian case. I think Paolo is going to present the work.
Okay, thank you very much. I hope you all listen to me. I have to share my screen. What is share? Okay, Do you see? Can you see my screen?
Yes.
That's okay. I'm sorry. Then the work I wish to present today is something is still ongoing. It's a research project conducted by Dr. Professor Cecilia Goiello and myself about the virus spreads, in particular in this case the COVID-19. The idea, the problem I want to present starts during the revision process of two papers in which the reviewers asked for additional additional validation, additional tests, a test with a different set of data. And so we ask ourselves how data contribute to the differentiation of the models, and this is quite known, but especially how the quality of data can affect this information. The model we used in this approach is a third model in the presentation, sorry. The hypothesis we performed, it's classical, it's quite a classical model. I do not repeat the usual definition. I just want to put in evidence the fact that it's a classical, mainly a classical SEIR model, in which we have differentiated the I classes, the I classes separated into people which do not know to be infected and people which know to be infected. I see is people which is infected, is infectious, but do not know his condition, that condition. While IQ is the people which is in some way informated, is by diagnosis, by test, by somewhere, and so it's also isolated from the other population. IC is not isolated. And in addition, we have this Q quarantine class, which has different meaning with respect to the one just presented, because quarantine is not is a class in which people go only if a forcing control send them there. The forcing control is called the U1, is denoted by U1, is a sort of is the control which drives people to go and do tests or to isolate in a preventive way. The division and ICAQ. As long with AE respect the classical time scheduling of the virus evolution. Dates are not fixed because you know there is a long discussion of the duration of the steps, but however, there is the incubation period that we modeled with E. There is a first period of infectivity without symptoms, then without knowing it as our IC, and then the classical situation in which the infection is manifested. As a particular note, inside IC, we include also the asymptomatic individuals, the ones that remains no asymptomatic, remains asymptomatic during all the evolution. So they never becomes aware, and they are never discovered. It's an important question. Q is, as I said, the part of the population which is isolated waiting for test, or which is self-isolated in waiting for evolution. Evolution means test, or means the classical quarantine, the time to wait before can go out. These are the equations more or less classical. We have the transitions coefficients related with the time constants. There are the coefficient, the scale coefficient, which are required just to correct the dimension of the quantities described. There is the input rate of the new individuals, the B, the S dot equation, the death rate, and so on. It's quite known, quite traditional. As well as the inputs we consider at the five, we try to introduce all the possible contributions. We have U1, which is, as I just said, the control which drives people to go to a test or to put in isolated the situation before evaluating their possible negative condition. In fact, the they go, okay, U1 takes people which do not know to be infected in any situation and bring them to the quarantine class. The second input is not, is U5. U5 is the input in which allow to leave the quarantine class. It's essentially the test phases. So people in quarantine can perform tests, and according to the result, they are infected or they are susceptible because they are not infected. U2 is the most famous, the most usual input is the isolation of the of people. It multiplies beta according to a factor 1 minus U2. In this sense, U2 equal to 0 means no isolation, classical situation. U2 equal to 1 is the monk situation, each one in one room is fully isolated. U3 and U4 are two inputs which describe the therapeutical, the medical aspect. They both are applied in the IQ class, and they model the two different medical activity. There is U4, which as for U2, modulates, reduces the death coefficient, which denotes the medical activity to reduce mortality, but without fighting the virus. It's just a way to keep alive the person, like for assisted ventilation, or any therapy which can assist to keep the patient alive. While U3 is a direct therapy against the virus. So there are two different ways of acting, and in the results, these two ways are evident. This model and every problem can be posed on once one has a dynamical model. For example, one can, as we have already seen, perform site identification, fitting in some situation, find the parameters, and adapt the model in particular case, like in this one, or perform a study on the differentiation, the parameter, differentiation of the model according to the local situation, the particular situations. In fact, we know that all the coefficients are function of different factors. Different factors, which are environmental factor, individual factor, personal factor, social factor, and so on. And so one can try to express each coefficient as the product of different factors. Okay.
A couple of minutes more, Paolo.
A couple of minutes, okay. Thanks. And this is another case. So just to show which is the problem. The problem is that we try to focalize to the quality of the input. The input to the model, corresponds to a high level command, for example, stay at home, or for example, close the school, or for example, nightlife ban, and so on. And we try to, I skipped this one, we try to focalize to the identification of this this block, the identification of which is the relationship between the high level commands and the input system, the input to the system, like we know. Instead of measurement, of course, we have to work with estimations, which is strongly affected by noise on the signals. A characterization of the noise is difficult because we have some noises which are periodic. You see, for example, the tests are performed with a weak periodicity. The weekend is not, work is lower and during the week is higher. A different, in this case, we have some impulsive, periodic impulsive disturbance which affected the data on Sunday, as is on Sunday. This is the last 2 weeks of the epidemic. The dismissed also, it seems to be random, but Sunday is of course characterized by a lower value. The only random, actually random value is the dead. In fact, it's possible to see. So the problem is that the signal is strongly affected by noise with different kind of noises. And so, to do a quantitative and correct analysis, a filtering, elaboration, analysis must be performed in order to use that data. Otherwise, it's not working. Our identification makes use of these quantities. The quantities are quantities that the national sites makes available. So all the positive, the total case, the new positive, the dismissed, the death. There are additional information which have been added more recently, so the more analytic information which is used but only recently. These are the measurements used for the identification. The identification is very simple because we the aim is to have a day by day value of the controls. So you have the function UI for each day. And so the identification is performed day by day with a simple least squares approach. This is the result of identification. The blue line, which seems the enveloped of the, the red bars, is the actual identified simulated values. The red bars are the data. So it's obvious that there is a perfect fitting because identifying over one single step produces a perfect, you don't have the dynamics behind. There is just one step identification. This can be seen for all the other values identified. The problem is that all the perturbations are on the signals identified. So this is U2, you see. Red is the raw data. Blue is just a time filtering to make a little bit smoother the data. And these are the other results. Which is the meaning of the title we gave. Analyze this data, it's possible to, from one side, to establish, trying to establish a relationship between high level comments and values of the control. On the other side, one can study the effects on the population of such high level comments. For example, in the isolation contribution, the large red, red pink, zone corresponds to the lockdown. This second bar from this corresponds to this bar actually corresponds to a second decree that prolonged the time, and this third one to the last one, the decree of the 10 April, which established the final time. It's interesting to study that in correspondence of each decree, there is a decrease of attention of people. It's a social. And can be socially justified or interpreted in some sense. This is the actual situation, the summer. It's possible to see that summer we have a reduction of the level of attention or isolation with respect to this previous phase. This is the present, the last days. And just to see which kind of analysis, qualitative, because data is very noisy, but can be refined for better results. For example, it's known that to have a regression number smaller than one with this formulation, it's required that U1 is greater than this value. These two zones separate the good from the good is the blue, and the bad zone is the red. And in fact, during the lockdown, we were up, we were in the good zone, and now we are a little bit lower. Looking at the actual effects, so looking at the fact that we have a lower number of infected until about half of May, which the derivative of this function start to increase, more or less in this zone, we can imagine, we can suppose that the bar, the line, the threshold between the bad and good zone is a little bit lower with respect to the computed one. And so this can suggest that R0 is lower than 3.5. A previous speaker said that it's about to his computations and brought to 2.5, so a lower number. I concluded the use of raw data produces also this side effect in correspondence of this is it's possible to see that inside the circle there is a perturbation, it's a loss of smoothness of the function. It corresponds to this lower peak. It's obviously it depends on the data. It's not an actual decrease of tension of isolation. And it's nice to note that this decrease corresponds exactly to the period around the 1st of May, when we had a very long weekend. And maybe during that very long weekend, the data were collected in a not efficient way. So this decrease maybe is due to that factor. The same analysis can be conducted on every other input. This is U4, the therapy action, the one that keeps alive, maintains the situation of the patient. It's nice to see that this identification, despite the quantitative values to be studied, but qualitative, it's easy, it's nice to see, it's useful to see. Now it's not nice, I'm sorry. It's one of the best or the worst case. In the case of the maximum flux of infected people to the hospitals, to the assistance, we had the worst worst assistance. This motivates the high number of death in this period. With lowering the number of infected, it's producing a higher efficiency in the therapy action. So also these relationships is nice to be put in evidence by this analysis. The same kind of analysis can be performed for all the other inputs. And this is the first step in which one can try to, first of all, to quantify the actual values of the inputs, because as I said, it's easy to say U1 equal to 3, but it's very difficult to say what social, political, the world must do to have U1 equal to. On the other side, you can evaluate and estimate the actual inputs, the actual effects, the actual modification we applied to the system to evaluate the correspondence between what I want that is done, what we want to be done, and what actually is happened to the system in this correspondence with the high level and numerical correspondence of the input. This work is going on, of course, because this is just at first the justification of the fact that it works in some sense, so we want to go on with the signal analysis, with the identification, with the interpretation of the results. Thank you very much. Your
okay, thank you very much, Paolo. I think we ran out of time for question. We have just like 1 minute. So if there is either a flash one or we keep for offline discussion, if there are more articulate questions. Meanwhile, I leave the time to prepare, for the next presentation. There is a multi-criteria approach for risk assessment of COVID-19 in urban district lockdown by Maria Piafanti, Fabio Parisi, and San Giorgio. Sorry, I don't know the first name. So I don't know who's going to present.
To all?
Maybe.
One moment.
Okay. Okay, Fabio Parisi is going to present. Thank you, Fabio. The floor is yours.
Okay, good morning to all. I am Fabio Parisi, and I will introduce a paper called The Multicriteria Approach for Risk Assessment of COVID-19 in Urban District Lockdown.
You can start, Fabio, whenever you want.
Yes, okay. Sorry. Well, in this slide, a summary of the content of the presentation is shown. First, in the problem definition, the main topic of the work is introduced. The global pandemic caused by SARS-CoV-2, the spreading of the disease in Italy, and subsequent so internal government policies. After, the methodology used is presented. As in the image, mainly a multi-criteria approach typically used in risk analysis is exploited to model the problem. an optimization approach is applied, and then the results are compared with a nonlinear model. The aim of the work is to perform a preliminary analysis in which a risk index could represent a support for the administration in partial reopening decision policies during extreme phases like lockdown. As a public domain, the spreading of the virus began in China, but in a few months, a great number of foreign countries reported their first infection due to the intensive network of connection and transportation worldwide. With the spreading of the virus, countries started to apply different internal policies, including forced lockdown condition for all citizens. But since a generalized lockdown is not considered as a repeatable policy to avoid catastrophic economical consequences to our society, one important question is how to gradually stop the lockdown, avoiding boosting of disease, and also avoiding deep economical consequences. Italy became the first country after China in which the infection caused severe consequences, principally in Lombardia region, where the first official Italian COVID detection happened. Because of severity of contagion in Lombardia, the Italian government defined the red zone in the 8th of March. Successively, urgent measures to contain the spread of COVID on the entire national territory was defined in the 11th of March. Despite the restrictive measures, many students and workers have left Lombardy to return to their regions and city of birth. The Apulia region created a web-based platform to monitor the number of citizens returning from the red zones, which recorded about 23,000 warnings. The Italian government imposes more restrictive lockdown conditions also in southern Italy after March 22, preventing travel and leaving homes. As a result of the days before the lockdown, the number of infection rapidly grew up. In this condition, the 8th of April shows the effect before the maximum restriction in Italy and the Apulia regions, while the 22nd of April shows the effect obtained after 14 days of complete restrictive measures in the Apulia region. In this slide, shows a resume of the previous slides and represent the diffusion of the pandemic in the Apulia region. The highlighted steps are part of the assumption necessary to analyze the pandemic situation in the region, mainly to the particular temporal distribution of government measures. Well, in this paper, proposes an index to compute a general indication of the risk in urban district in order to support the decision for administration and identify possible strategies during and after the lockdown condition at a regional level. The index both considers socioeconomic aspect and number of infection in the area. In addition, the index can be used to analyze different scenarios based on different administrative policy in order to compute the related risks. Well, the proposed work is carried out in four phases: a definition of the problem, data acquisition, an optimization-based calibration, and comparison with an artificial neural networks. Well, in a first phase of the work, the risk of COVID-19 in urban district is analyzed to identify the involved parameters and classify them in criteria, subcriteria, and intensity as shown in figure. In this phase, the problem is structured according to the theory of the multi-criteria approach by Sati. In addition, by following the footstep of existing risk assessment procedure, three well-known risk factors are defined and customized for considered phenomena: hazard, vulnerability, and exposure. In these works, three factors are defined as criteria: the hazard, the vulnerability, and the exposure. And for each of them, there are sub-criteria. Well, talking about the hazard, we can say that it considers the possibility of contagion, and this is characterized by three sub-criteria. The vulnerability evaluates the urban district's characteristics and contemplates about 56 sub-criteria. Talking about exposure, we can say that it evaluates the typology of inhabitants in this case. Well, vulnerability is defined as the inability to resist the effects of an hostile phenomenon. In this work, the vulnerability is identified by socioeconomic structure of the urban districts, considered as the number of enterprises and economical activities. Why is vulnerability so important? Because setting to zero vulnerability would help to set to zero the risk. This is because vulnerability is an indirect way to quantify the connection between people that could lead the boost of the contagion. Well, by closing commercial activities with its restrictive official policies, the aim of the government was to try to set to zero what we identify as a vulnerability in this work. Well, for the calibration of the model in the second phase, a data set is obtained to provide the necessary information. It is developed by an acquisition and pre-processing procedure to achieve pandemic and socioeconomical data collection. In particular, data are acquired for the Apulia region for 257 urban districts divided in the six local governments. Data regarding the intensity of subcriteria are acquired from Italian Civil Protection and from National Institute of Statistics. In addition, data regarding the effective infection useful for the calibration are also taken from the data of 8th of April from the data from Italian Civil Protection. Well, in the third phase, the model to obtain the index R-COVID-19 is calibrated by exploiting a nonlinear optimization technique on the data collected from the data collected in the previous phase. In particular, this index is associated with every urban district and is expressed as a function of the column vector of the criteria and column vector of the subcriteria. By taking account all three components of the hazard vulnerability and exposure in the factorial formula that we see on the top of the slide. Well, the Apulia region is an effective area to calibrate the model for the particular condition of the epidemic beginning. The return of 23,000 citizens from the red zone generated a diffused initial distribution for the virus on the territory. Well, the consequent spread of the infection occurred in the basis of hazard, vulnerability, and exposure factors of the urban district. To this aim, the calibration exploits data of infected people of 24th of March and as the starting point of the infection, and data from of the 8th of April into the 8th of April to analyze the effect of the contagion in calibrated model. Well, it is possible to define a F function that evaluates the difference between the R-COVID and the effective infection in the 8th of April for each urban district. To calibrate the vector V and WV, it is assumed that the index of risk infections should be as close as possible to the effective number of infection registered on the 8th of April. F in this case represents the quadratic sum of the difference between proposed risk index and effective consequences of the various contagion phenomenon. Consequently, F can be selected as the objective function to be minimized by the satisfying a set of constraints on vector V and WV. The constraints are set to avoid negative or null values to the weights and to normalize to one the risk index. Okay, here we can see what we obtain with our analysis. By exploiting the first three phases, we achieve the quantification of the influence of every parameter in the urban district involved in the spread of COVID-19. The resulting difference is expressed in the percentage, and the description of the result follows the parameter classification like exposure, hazard, and vulnerability. The most important parameter belong to the criterion of the exposure and regards the age of the inhabitant with a value of 54%. The hazard and all three related parameters are of intermediate importance, infected people, not immune people, and mobility. Vulnerability has only few of 65 related parameters resulting of high importance, and others which can affect less the effect of contagion, like coffee and restaurant and supermarket. It's important to note that in total, hazard vulnerability and exposure are very similar importance in the analysis. Well, the proposed approach is used to obtain three possible forecasting scenarios. In particular, three regional risk maps are achieved by applying the studied region, three different administrative hypothetical policy. The index is able to outcome a numerical value ranging from 0 to 1 for every considered Umbar district to forecast the risk of contagion by using the 65 input data. Well, the three considered scenario are the full lockdown condition, where only companies and institutions from primary needs are operative in the territories, a lockdown condition with the hypothesis of partial reopening, where only some activities are kept closed, the most dangerous activities. Then there is a no lockdown condition, when the hypothesis of full reopening of all business activities and institutions. How it is possible to see is that the big cities represent the zone with most risk in all scenario. On the contrary, there are difficulties in predict in small city, in other Umbar district, because this depends on the local presence of specific kind of companies. Yes, the higher level that is possible to see it's in Bari, in full lockdown, in full open scenario, where there are the lower level is registered in small cities like Volturno, Castelnuovo della Daunia, that has almost risk zero in the hypothesis of full lockdown condition, thanks to zero infection, very limited population mobility, and low presence of activity in the territory. We can say that the obtained result suggests that for every Umbar district, the local administration could have an idea of the importance of the kind of activity on their country, on their territory. Well, the used approach shows some peculiarities, despite the fact that the model equation is defined a priori with a factorial form. It's strongly based on data from civil protection and National Institute of Statistics, and let to understand how much the parameter influence the phenomenon. Different disease with the comparison with a deep feed-forward deep neural network trained on the same data for every urban district. From this model, we can have another index that has been compared with the index obtained from the previous model. And this is what we can see about the comparison between the two different index. This is the full reopening scenario, forecasting scenario. In the right, the additional map shows the difference between the result of the two approaches. In particular, 61 of 257 Urbar district, the two methods obtained slightly different risk value, and only for three of all the urban districts, there is a relevant differences in representing the yellow. There is no case in which the difference are from zero or lower risk to high risk.
Fabio, you should wrap up. From now on, you're taking the question time. So basically, if there are no questions, there are 5 minutes more. But if you use these 5 minutes, then we cannot take questions. Thank you.
Okay. Well, only some summing up. The NA-based approach has a good accuracy that can be improved with data also coming from all Italy. But in this approach, it's difficult to understand the importance of each parameter. In this case, the N can be difficult to use by also administration and government that can have the need of some tools to understand how to manage this kind of condition on their own territories. In the other end, the other method is able to achieve good forecasting, and it used a simple factorial equation in which is simple to understand the importance of the different parameters. Well, if we conclude, we can say that in this paper, proposes the calibration of this R-COVID index that is devoted to the to predicting the risk of contagion in Yuba district by considering epidemic characteristic epidemic data and economical and social data of the territory. The methodology is based on multi-criteria approach that start on the well-known definition of the risk by means of the three factors: hazard, vulnerability, and exposure. Hence, the single out criteria and some criteria are considered in the definition of R-COVID on the index R-COVID-19 by factorial form that is calibrated by solving the problem shown. The model is developed by considering the set of urban districts to predict the risk of contagion, including socioeconomic and pandemic aspects in the analysis. The research tries to reach the ambitious result of forecasting the risk in different scenarios, assuming different administrative policies in the Apulia region. The work novelty issue regards the quantification of the influences of each parameter in the urban district and the usage of economical and social data to try to understand, try to compute a general index that could be a some kind of indication for the administration. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Fabio. We have 2 minutes for a very quick question. Is there any question from the audience? If not, I remind you that then we will have like a common moment together. Oh, Guido. Guido, go ahead. Guido.
Yes, thank you for the presentation. I just want to ask you if this approach can be scaled down to a single city, to be able to forecast what happens to the single districts of the city, for example, to a campus area. Thank you.
Well, thank you for the question. The model is a data-driven model. So we need data of the district to try to scale the model to different discrete dimension. So we need first data, and then I think we can scale it.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you very much for the question and for the presentation. We can move forward. Thank you, Fabio. We can move forward to the next presentation. That is COVID-19 modeling, Siddharthi and beyond, by Giulia Giordano, Franco Blanchini and Patrizio Colaneri. The presenter is Patrizio Colaneri, that I warmly welcome and leave the floor to.
Okay, can you see the screen?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, sorry, I have a problem here. Full screen, I don't find this full screen. Anyway, okay, thank you, Alessandro, for giving me the possibility to
try control L or control enter.
Control L is okay.
Good.
Is now okay?
Yeah. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you, Alessandro, for setting up this nice, let's say, session for the CIDRA workshop. So in this talk, I would like to, let's say, present very quickly the SIDARTE model, because it's been already presented many times during the last months, and try to go a little bit farther by presenting new models and the work we are currently working on after, let's say, starting from, let's say, a few weeks back. So after some preliminaries, I will briefly present the SIDARTE, and then revise a little bit the COVID-19 pandemic in Italy from outbreak to the real pandemic. And then I will present two new models. One is called SPREAD and the other one is a networked SIRE model. Okay, we all know that, mathematical models are very important. And by the way, is the only thing we can do being, control engineers. We are not, magicians, whatever. So I would like only to remember to recall this very nice and timely workshop in April 24. By the way, our paper on SIDARTE was published in April 20. And the important feature was the distinction between dynoside and undynoside positive individuals. This is very important, as well as the distinction between symptomatic and asymptomatic positive individuals. So the genesis of SIDARTE was something like this. So we start studying, at the end of February, beginning of March, I received two phone calls, one from my daughter from Politecnico San Matteo di Pavia, saying that, the spread of the epidemic was really bad at the beginning of March. And they had a number of data from nasal swabs, both for symptomatic and asymptomatic individuals. For the first 10 days after the outbreak of the epidemic, people went to the pronto soccorso, I don't know in English, and they were tested either if they were symptomatic or asymptomatic. So we had the first idea of couple of parameters that I will present in a few seconds. Then I received a second phone call from Franco saying that Giulia Giordano had a draft of a model, of epidemiological model, where this distinction between symptomatic, asymptomatic, and dynoside and not dynoside individuals were a model. And we asked the medical people in Pavia to check the model, to validate the model in a clinical way. And so we started, we added the a state, which is the T state of threatened individuals, so people going in the ICU cure unit. And we started, identifying parameters from data from Protezione Civile. And also we tried to, set up some prediction on future scenarios, depending on the progressive containment measures that were put by the government, starting from March till June. Okay. So model consists, so the result is in this paper that was miraculously, published in Nature Medicine in April 2020. Okay, so here is a detailed graph of the model. We have 8 states susceptible, non-diagnosed infected but asymptomatic, non-diagnosed infective but symptomatic, A. Then diagnosed asymptomatic, recognized asymptomatic, and threatened, let's say, people going to the ICU unit. And of course, deaths, extincts, and recovered people, recovered from, let's say, both from, let's say, the undiagnosed states that, and diagnosed states. So, I mean, it's it's an extension of classical epidemiological models, but with eight states. So, it's important to notice the parameters. There are 13 parameters, so a lot of parameters. 4 contagion parameters, alpha, beta, gamma, delta, and 2 epsilon and theta, 2 diagnosis parameters. It's very important, very sensitive, by the way. And they work as tuning knobs to try to control the epidemic. Okay. Here is the standard, model, Kolmogorov equation. What it is interesting for me as a control theorist is to put this model in a feedback form, in the sense that you can extract a state X, that is a 5-dimensional state IDA, R, and T, and with an input and output, YS. And so this is going to be a positive system, linear, by the way, feedback by the fraction of susceptible individual in equation 7. All other variables, yield and extincts, are integral of the former state variable. So they enter in the model in series. So they are not so important, although they are useful to compute the lethality of the virus, both the real lethality and the perceived lethality. Okay, so this is a feedback scheme, just a few theoretical results. With this feedback scheme, you can easily compute what is called the basic reproduction number, that is very important, R0, as a function of the 13 parameters. What it is interesting that this number is the H infinity norm of the positive system, linear system from U to YS. So it is easily computable, okay? I haven't seen the literature, this interpretation of epidemiological model as a feedback scheme, even though something similar has been done by Vespignani in his old papers. Okay, so you can compute also in closed form, more or less in closed form, the equilibrium of X of S bar and yield and extincts in this way. If you see the first equation 10, you can, you can write the intersection of the left-hand line and the logarithm in the left and right, and you see the value, the intersection of the herd immunity value of fraction of susceptibles. For instance, if R0 is equal to 2, you have 0.2 as intersection. This means that most of the population has been infected. Okay. So we are very far from herd immunity, by the way. Interestingly, and quite classically, the stability is given by the product using simple small gain theorem on the positive system. Stability is given by the product of R0 and the fraction of susceptible less than one. Now, as I said, we had in Italy a progressive number of containment measures from at day one, the basic reproduction number was 238, even though there are other estimates ranging from 2 to 4. At day four, there was the closing of the schools and let's say some attention, starting attention on the, let's say awareness of the epidemic, so hygiene and behavioral recommendations and so on. So R0 went down to 1.66. Then asymptomatic individuals were almost no longer detected, so R0 raises up to 1.8. Then there was a partial lockdown, so R0 went down again, and then national lockdown, and eventually R0 went below one, and then even below one, I mean 0.85, because there was, let's say, at day 38, which is in probably beginning or in April, the start of a wide testing campaign in order to identify as mild symptomatic or even asymptomatic individuals that were put in quarantine. So, I mean, R0 went down. Now, the model fit to, I mean, there was, of course, identification, piecewise identification of the parameters, piecewise parameters, and till time 40. So from 40 to 60 is just the prediction that fit very well the data, both from infected and recovered, okay? So the fit was very good. And but what is important is to understand what would have been happening if no restriction at all were taken at the time. So if you see the graph in the left up part of the screen, you see the very big peak of infective in red. You see a lot of death, the black line, which is probably, I don't know, 1 million or whatever death, if no restriction at all would have been taken. If on the contrary, strong measures, in the case of strong measure, you see a very low, not really very low, but much lower than the one above, infective, and the number of death that is, let's say, I counted 12,000 deaths. So the population is 60 million, so it's Italian data, okay? Interestingly, what happened more or less is that lockdown was weakened, but also started massive testing and contact tracing, okay? Not really massive, but I mean, that was enough to reduce the number of deaths. If you see in the screen, the black line is around 35,000 deaths, which is more or less what we have now in 1 year, so 350. But also if we take today, which is 7 months or so, if you see the number of deaths is more or less 35,000. So good prediction. Okay. So the message of SIDARTE, I mean, is importance to distinguish between symptomatic, diagnosed and undiagnosed people, and the importance of mass testing and contact very, very, let's say, quick and strong contact tracing of people to be put in quarantine. lockdown could be reasonably mitigated only under these conditions. And of course also, I mean, changing contagion parameters, which means putting masks or let's say social distancing, as we usually say, and other measures, okay? Okay, this ends the first part on, let's say, on the Siddhartha model. Then it became apparent in the beginning of May.
Patrizio, sorry, you have 4 minutes left. So for the second part, try to allocate these 4 minutes.
Oh my God. No. Are you sure, Alessandro?
You have to finish 4:10, including questions. So if there are no questions, there are 4 minutes until 4:10.
Okay, so spread. It became apparent that it was important to, in order to prevent a second wave of contagion, to monitor and to control the epidemic. Okay, so we were asked from University of Pavia, from Medicine, to build a model that separates a population in these four sets, in the four clusters. The first is with a negative molecular test, swab, and negative antibodies, and all the other three combinations, of course. So minus, minus, plus, minus, plus, plus, and minus, plus. And we put together a model with, that is still a compartmental model, and adding, of course, deaths, which is a data that is always available. And we estimate the parameter by a combination of standard Kalman filter and this pair to have finally parameters that are this was constant. And this, and using also, let's say, a trick, which is the choice estimators here to estimate the undetected infections. So if you see the blue line, the infected, and the estimate is in the dashed blue line, but the real number of infected is the continuous blue line. That also that is much higher, is 2-3 times higher, and this is in accordance with other work in this. And this also results in a number of recovered that are not recognized as recovered, that is the green line, that is much larger than the star green line here. Okay, so this is the RT. As you see in the right, the RT is went below one, but now is rising up. Now in Lombardy, these are data from Lombardy, and now we have today or yesterday, by the way, we have a RT of 1.2. Okay, this is the last, but it's a network system with a contact connectivity parameters. And we took the situation in Italy, and this is a paper that has been sent for revision to Nature Communication, and if you want to write this reference, is posted in the archive. And so this is the situation in Italy. What next? Next is that we are experiencing a rebound of the virus that is due to after vacation traffic interaction, or it is a second wave of vacation of infection. We don't know really. We have to wait what will be happen when school reopen. And future work are on the extension of this compartmental model, taking individual behaviors like in opinion dynamics, and working, try to work out stochastic master model with moment closure, and try to understand where and who to test in order to combat the epidemic in a better way. Thank you very much, and sorry if I'm late. Alessandro, I'm late.
It's yes. Okay, no, but only one minute. Thank you very much. I just want to forward greetings from Pino Menga, who is here with us. And okay, yes. I don't think there is time for questions. So if there are questions, then you can keep for the, let's say, coffee break. So I have to switch to the next work. Okay. Where Lorenzo Zino is going, but I don't have requests for questions, so apparently there are no questions.
Okay.
The next work is a metapopulation activity-driven network model for COVID-19 in Italy by Francesco Parino, Lorenzo Zino, Maurizio Porfiri, and myself, and it's going to be Lorenzo Zino that present the work.
Okay, thank you, Alessandro, for the introduction, and good afternoon to all of you. Is it working? Okay. So in this work, we will mostly focus on modeling and understanding the effect of non-pharmaceutical intervention for COVID-19. So as all of you know, unfortunately, there are no pharmaceutical interventions for the current pandemic. And so the only way to combat the spread of COVID-19 is via non-pharmaceutical interventions. We have classified, we have found two big classes of non-pharmaceutical interventions that are the first one, which comprises those interventions aiming at reducing social activity, for instance, by implementing social distancing or forbidding gatherings and so on and so forth. And a second class of non-pharmaceutical intervention that consists in implementing mobility restrictions, such as asking for self-certification to move or even implementing travel bans. In this work, we will propose a parsimonious model that is able to capture the spatial spread of the disease, which is key to model mobility restrictions, and which directly includes social activity and its heterogeneous time-varying nature, which is key to model non-pharmaceutical intervention aiming at reducing social activity. In such a way, we are able to directly incorporate non-pharmaceutical intervention into a tractable mathematical model. Then we will tailor this model to the ongoing COVID-19 outbreak in Italy, and we parameterize it using available data and epidemic data. And finally, we will present some results which allows to compare different non-pharmaceutical intervention, in particular disentangling the effect of activity reduction and mobility restriction, either considering the implementation of NPIs and considering their relaxation. So let's start with the model. We consider a metapopulation model in which we have N individuals, that is the population of the entire population, which is partitioned into K communities. Well, NH is the population in community H. Each community represents a geographic area. We introduce a mobility parameter beta that measures the fraction of population that commute from between different communities, and a routing matrix W that determines the direction of such a mobility, so that the entry W12 tells the fraction of the population that moved from community one that goes to community two. So as you see, this metapopulation structure allows to include and represent mobility in a direct way. To deal with social activity, we rely on the mathematical framework of activity-driven networks, which became very popular in the last decade to model heterogeneous time-varying networks. So briefly, we consider P activation classes, each one characterized by a parameter between 0 and 1 that is called activity, and we assume that individuals are partitioned into these classes uniformly among the communities, such that eta I times nh is the fraction of individuals belonging to the ith class in community h. So the model works as follows. At each unit time step that from this moment on we fix as a day, so at each day, a fraction ai of the individual in the ith class activates. Then a fraction beta of the active individuals move to another province, according to the routing matrix W, while the other stays in their province. All active individuals generate random interactions within their province they are. And then at the end of the day, they go back to their own province. So this activity-driven network-inspired structure allows to directly include social activity. So including the mobility and activity allows to naturally introduce some parameters to model non-pharmaceutical interventions. In particular, we introduce two parameters, alpha and beta, that capture activity reduction and mobility restrictions, respectively, so that the activities of individuals captured by the parameter AI are scaled down by the parameter alpha, while mobility that is captured by the mobility parameter B is scaled down by parameter beta. So to sum up, the individuals in community H with activity class AI generate a number of interactions that depends on the model parameters and on these non-pharmaceutical intervention parameters alpha and beta. The last ingredient is a model for the epidemic progression. So we decided to keep it as simple as possible. And so we used basically an SEIR model. So in which susceptible individuals that have a contact with infectious individuals become first exposed. And then after a period of time that is regulated by a parameter nu, they become infectious. They stay infectious for a certain time that is regulated by a parameter mu, and then they become non-infectious. So what we did differently from the standard SEIR model is that we split the R compartment into two compartments. And this is mainly due to the fact that in order to estimate and to identify the model parameters, we rely on the reported number of deaths. And since there is typically a delay between the actual end of the infectiousness and reported and the time in which the data is reported, we added a separate compartment for removed when they are reported. And we model this delay through the parameter gamma, sorry. So as you see, all the transitions are spontaneous, apart from the transition from susceptible to exposed, which is driven by an interaction of a susceptible individual with an infectious individual. So such interaction to model and to count the number of such interactions, it is possible, even though it's not trivial because the model is not simple since there are classes and communities, and the number of interactions actually depends on the class and of the community in which the individuals are. But this number of interactions can be written as a function of the model parameters and the state of the system, taking into account both the active contacts that are generated and the passive contacts that can be received from other active individuals that generate contacts to the individuals in a certain class and in a certain community. So to end up putting all these ingredients together, we have our dynamical system that is characterized by a set of difference equation in which we have four equations for each class. So as you see, this model, which is obtained by combining a metapopulation model and an activity-driven network-inspired model, allows to directly capture mobility and social activity. And in this way, through the introduction of two parameters, alpha and beta, we can study non-pharmaceutical interventions. So we tailored our model to COVID-19 outbreak in Italy, and we considered as a granularity for the communities, Italian provinces. We took data on the provinces from Istat on census data, and we parameterized activity using age stratified data on social contacts. Mobility parameters are again identified from daily commuting and long range mobility data available at Istat. And we took the epidemic parameter from the literature on COVID-19. Then the remaining parameters, including alpha and beta during the lockdown, are identified from epidemic data. And in particular, they are identified by simulating the dynamical system and fitting the number of reported deaths available from the Department of Health. Okay, so with this model, we want to understand the effect of activity reduction and mobility restrictions. And we start our analysis by studying the effect of early implementation of mobility restrictions. So in this plot, we can see the effect of implementing different levels of mobility restrictions for different level of activity reduction. And we see the relative variation of the number of deaths with respect to the case with only activity reduction and no mobility restriction. So from this plot, what it seems is that mobility restrictions are effective only for a range of levels of activity reductions, in particular for alpha that goes from 0.3 to 0.7. But from epidemic data, we have identified alpha something slightly less than 0.2. So at our first sight, it seems that mobility restriction were not effective as NPIs. But is this true? And in order to answer this question and to better understand the effect of mobility restriction, what is very important is to have a network model. Why? Because we can see what happens at the province level. And when we go to observe the effect of mobility restrictions at the province level, what we see is that there is a huge difference between different provinces. For instance, there are some provinces like Bergamo, where it seems that the implementing mobility restrictions has no effect on reducing the number of deaths. While there are other provinces like South Sardinia, where instead implementing mobility restrictions seems to have a large effect even for values of alpha that are lower than the range identified. So to better understand this effect, this different effect of mobility restrictions for different provinces, we put forward our non-negative matrix factorizations. So basically, we took all these matrices counting the number of deaths for different values of alpha and beta for all the provinces, and we wrote them, we approximate them as the sum of two basis matrices. Basically, one where mobility restrictions have effect and one where mobility restrictions have no effect. And depending on the weight that the different matrices, that the different provinces give to these two basis matrices, we clusterized two different sets of provinces. One where mobility restrictions have a strong effect in reducing the number of deaths, and one that were of the provinces that were unaffected by mobility restrictions.
Lorenzo, this is just to let you know that you're using the question time. For the moment, okay. There are no reservations for questions. Thanks.
Okay, I will wrap up. So just a quick remark on this clustering is that as expected, for instance, most of the provinces in Lombardy where there were the first cases were unaffected by mobility restrictions because unfortunately there were already a large number of infected individuals in the province. But this is, there are some exceptions. For instance, we can see these two provinces that are Varese and Monza Brianza that are very close to Milan and they are affected by mobility restrictions. So it seems our hypothesis is that in these provinces, there are many people commuting to Milan or to closer provinces in which there were a higher number of initial cases. So this just to say that the result of this clusterization is not trivial. So to end up, we ran a similar analysis for the relaxation of NPIs. And what we observed is that in this case, there is always no effect or a minor effect of mobility restrictions. So what it seems is that when one have to plan relaxation of NPIs, it's very important to calibrate the level of activity reduction, but mobility restrictions seems at least, it seems possible to uplift mobility restrictions. So to wrap up, we have developed a simple model that relies on the identification of few parameters that allows to model mobility, to include mobility and activity in an epidemic model, and thus allows to model non-pharmaceutical interventions. We have calibrated the model on the ongoing COVID-19 outbreak in Italy, and the result obtained allows to elucidate the role of activity reduction and mobility restrictions in different phases of the epidemic outbreak. So in our future research, we seek to study the model and find rigorous results, in particular, understanding the relation between local and global invasion thresholds for the model, and extend our what-if analysis to the next phases of the pandemics. And I just want to conclude thanking all of you for your attention and Francesco, Maurizio, Alessandro, who worked with me on this project.
Thank you, Lorenzo. Patrizio, quick question for Lorenzo.
Yeah, because I missed the model, unfortunately. So I wanted to ask the parameters. There are just a few parameters, if I understood correctly. They depend on I and H or are just constant? I mean.
So in the model, we assume them to be constant.
Is this a proper assumption, or I mean, you think that the contagion parameter should depend on also on the mobility and the class of?
At least in these cases, we were mostly interested in studying the effect of non-pharmaceutical interventions, and so we tried to keep the rest of the model as simple as possible to avoid confounding. But in order to develop a more realistic model, we believe that at least some of the parameters should be different for different classes. For instance, if you consider a class as a age cohort, then probably also the time needed to transition from one health state to the other may change.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
If I may add something, specifically the probability of infection lambda, to me it makes sense that it can remain constant because we are separating the phenomenon of contact from the phenomenon of infection. So this means that lambda is the per contact infection probability. That means that is the probability that two people, one person can get infected after a contact, upon contacting. And then this must be multiplied by other probabilities that are the probability of contact. So it makes sense. Concerning the transitions, on the other hand, I think that, for example, partitioning in age classes can make a lot of sense. Mauro, I don't know, yes. Patrizio, did I reply? Sorry, I cut it off.
Yeah, I replied. I mean, because I mean, looking at the serological data, you know, for instance, that the cluster of medical doctors have quite different behavior, the spread of the epidemic with respect to, I mean, people that are at home or after.
Yeah, correct, so, I mean, correct.
That's why.
But that lambda doesn't depend on the behavior.
No, lambda no, but I mean alpha and beta.
Yeah, alpha and beta, yes, correct. Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks. Mauro?
Yeah, just a quick question. It's just, I would like you to discuss a little bit this conclusion, so this result that some mobility restrictions could actually be less effective than activity reduction. So if I understood correctly. But so in this model, so I think that when the number of infected people is very small, so there are some quantization issues. So in this model, you assume that there are already a sufficient number of infected people in all the provinces. So since it's already spreaded, then restricting travel is definitely not going to help. But instead, in the other case, where there are regions with no infected people, so I think that might not be captured by a model with, continuous variable. Could you elaborate on this?
Yeah, so I think that one of the reasons we choose to consider provinces and not smaller, as finer granularity like municipalities is concerning this fact of having very small initial conditions which cannot be captured by a continuous model. And probably it's a similar problem also for understanding the effect of mobility when there are some provinces that with initial condition equal to zero. So what I just want to stress is that, for instance, here can be observed that mobility restrictions are not implemented at time zero. In the real world, but also in our simulations, which means that there is a certain amount of time in which people can move and in which the COVID-19 was already spread in the population. And this has been observed also in, there are many studies that says that COVID-19 was in Europe, at least from January.
Which okay, thank you.
Probably the initial condition is non-zero in all the provinces.
Okay, I should ask to conclude, guys, and then you can continue the discussion in the virtual coffee break. Sorry, but I have to play the bad guy in this context. So I would like to leave the floor to Francesco Casella. Can the COVID-19 epidemic be controlled on the basis of daily test reports?
So Alessandro, I hope you can hear me well.
Yes, and I see your screen. Go ahead, thanks.
Okay, thank you. So let me get the timer going. So the story of this work is a bit long. I worked on the first version of it very early on when basically we only had data about the Chinese outbreak and the European situation was pretty much open. that was mid-March 2020. A later version of this work was already presented at the IEEE workshop organized by Dabbene in April. And then finally, I recently published it on control system letters. And here we had a little bit more data, peer review feedback, and so it was further improved. And that's what I'm presenting right now. So a little bit of context, there is no vaccine yet for COVID. And it's now very clear that COVID is not a disease that you can leave running free, because that puts a huge demand on hospital beds and particularly on ICU beds. And it's unquestionable that this would cause public health systems to collapse. When numbers are low, testing and tracing can be effective to suppress the epidemic, but that only works when numbers are low enough that people who are doing this can actually follow all the cases. With larger numbers, it seems that the only viable strategy so far is to try to actively contain the number of cases, not just let it run free, through so-called non-pharmaceutical interventions, lockdowns, restrictions to mobility or to nightlife or whatever. And this is done based on numbers which come from daily reports of new infected cases, positive swab tests of the previous day or one of the current day, the total number of active cases, people who have been infected and have not yet recovered, a fraction of which is in hospitals, and possibly also the number of total cases. Now, the research question here is, can you actually, and that's the title of my paper, by the way, can the COVID epidemic process actually be controlled based on this data? That was what the question that I first asked to myself in March, when I got aware of some, what I think, peculiar characteristics of this disease. So a bit of modeling. The goal here is to capture the control relevant dynamics. The model that I eventually selected is basically the same that was introduced in the previous talk, only it's just a lumped model for an entire country. I have no regional compartments. There are mechanisms to flows from the different compartments. The first flow depends on the infectiousness parameter, beta, and also on how many infectious people and susceptible people you have. And then there is a flow going from exposed to infectious. This is due to incubation, basically. I separated the infectious and the ill compartment, or non-infectious, as other authors have called this, because ill people can be infectious and hence produce other ill people, or they can no longer be infectious, either because the COVID is apparently very infectious at the beginning, or because they are simply hospitalized or quarantined. And people remain ill but not infectious a lot longer than they are infectious. So you need to separate these two categories. And finally, you end up into the compartment of resistance or recovered people. I'm not counting the dead people here because numbers are significant, but in terms of percentage of ill people, it's still a very low number. So it's out of scope for the study that I want to carry out here. A couple of simplifying assumptions. The first, which seems to be to hold so far for the entire world, is that the number of people, of susceptible people that were actually infected, is a small percentage of the population. It is still not exactly clear how much. It could be 1%, 2%, maybe 10 or 15% in the worst cases, but it's still a very small fraction. So this allows us to basically assume that S is almost equal to N, and this allows to decouple some of the equations and come up with a simpler model which can only focus on these three variables. And it's basically a linear model as far as beta is constant, or it becomes a time-varying model or a nonlinear model if beta is changed. That's what we are focusing on. Another assumption is that only a fraction alpha of subjects will be tested, because there are many asymptomatic subjects which are not reached. We assume that this fraction is constant. Other authors also do that, which means that we can write exactly the same equations for the fraction of exposed, infectious, and ill people, that will be eventually tested. Those will have this subscript T, and they are a fraction alpha of the total number. So we can come up with a control-oriented model where basically we have these three equations. We take into account the fact that the infectiousness rate beta depends on a control variable U, which is the non-pharmaceutical interventions mandated by the government, and possibly by some other disturbances, which we don't know anything about. And then we have some output equations regarding variables which are actually reported daily by Protezione Civile or the equivalent in other countries. So the new daily cases, the active cases, and the total accumulated cases. And here, there is an essential feature for as far as the measurement is concerned, that there are delays between, let's say, people who are actually exposed or infectious and people who are actually reported as such. There's a total delay which depends to the time it takes to develop symptoms before you actually get tested. This was particularly important in February and March, where people were not really tested unless they really had bad symptoms. And also time for swab test processing, which can be as short as 1 or 2 days, but if there are queues, it can be longer than possibly 1 week. And that was actually the case in Italy for quite some time, and also more recently in the US due to the large number of cases. This model was validated with publicly available test reports from the outbreaks in China, Italy, France, and UK. I fitted, this was a kind of manual fit, not particularly sophisticated one, but good enough for my purposes. The parameters were fitted separately for each case. They turned out to be qualitatively the same. Maybe there's differences of 10 or 20%, but the orders of magnitude is always the same. I'm just going to present you briefly the case of Italy. This is the number of new daily cases. The effect of the delay is absolutely evident here. You see that lockdown was applied on day 19. That was March 11th or 12th. And the number of cases continued to increase exponentially for another 10 days or so before it started decreasing. This is the validation of the other two interesting measured variables. A is the number of active cases, so cases which were reported infectious and still not reported, no longer infectious, with two subsequent negative swabs. Here you see that there is a very large effect of delay. You apply lockdown here when you have something like 12,000 cases, active cases, and the peak is almost 10 times bigger, and it's a lot of time later because it takes a lot of time to recover from COVID. It's more than a month on average. Then we use this model in order to figure out how you can control this process. And yes, governments are solving control problems all the time, even if they maybe don't realize it. There's, I would say, the two main objectives that I'm focusing on. There could be others. The main objective in the COVID epidemic has always been to avoid overwhelming hospitals and ICUs, which means we should keep the number of active cases always below some threshold. Otherwise, the whole system comes crashing down. And there is basically two possible strategies to do that. One is a suppression, which means you observe the active cases and you don't do anything. So the control variable is zero, which corresponds to beta having the nominal value with no restrictions. And then when you cross some scaly threshold, the government gets scared and it just orders strict lockdown. So you change the control action to something very aggressive, so that beta over gamma, which is the reproduction rate, goes well below one. If you compute these two indicators, AP is the peak value of active cases, and then you compute the ratio between the peak value and the value at the time of crossing the threshold, what happened, in fact, in all those cases, was that this ratio was quite large. For example, in the case of Italy, it was the ratio between the number of active cases the day of lockdown and the peak was 8. In China was 10, and in France and UK, we got, I can't recall the numbers exactly, you see them in the paper, but the order of magnitude was always something like 10. So this can be predicted by the model if you have good tuning parameters. And it's a robust result as long as this U is strong enough that this thing is significantly below one. What is potentially interesting to notice is that maybe politicians may not be aware that if they order lockdown when they have, say, 1,000 people in hospital, numbers will go up by one order of magnitude before peaking. And if they understood that well, maybe they would have taken lockdown orders earlier. There is another possible strategy, which is known as mitigation. I quote Boris Johnson on the 18th of March, we will take the right steps at the right time. And the question is that actually possible in a COVID outbreak? In order to do so, you need to have a plan. This is some feed forward action that you will apply to non-pharmaceutical interventions view in order to get some target values of new cases and active cases and total cases. But then you will need some corrections because of uncertainty, and that can be represented as some kind of feedback based on the measured variables. Remember that those are affected by delay. So if we want to understand how controllable the system is, we can assume that we could apply, assuming very fine grained control of non-pharmaceutical interventions, which is optimistic, we could use some kind of gain scheduled feedback control, which introduces additional decision delay because you take some decision and before it's actually implemented, maybe some more days will pass. And then we make a very optimistic analysis, assuming that we know all the parameters, we design a gain scheduled controller, and we can analyze the loop transfer function while linearizing around a certain trajectory. And what is interesting is that this loop transfer function has one unstable pole if beta is large enough. So if the reproduction number is larger than one, this becomes unstable. And you have a total feedback loop delay, which can be as large as 15 days. And when I understood this, I remembered Gunther Stein's Bode lecture, Respect the Unstable. There was also a paper about this on Control System magazine several years ago. And I thought this is a possible recipe for disaster. In fact, the main results of my work can be summarized as follows. There is a nice paper by Karl Ostrom, almost 20 years old now, computing limitations of feedback, linear feedback control performance if you want to have a decent amount of robustness. And this is equivalent to say that if you have both unstable behavior and delay, the ratio between the delay time and the doubling time of the unstable mode should be around 22%. And now what happened at the beginning of the outbreak is that we had delays of 1 to 2 weeks and the doubling time was 3 to 4 days. So this ratio was not 0.2, it was like 2, 3, 4, 5. So more than one order of magnitude larger than the theoretical limit for controllability. I think this is an interesting figure to think about. I also reformulated this limitation in terms of what is the maximum value of the reproduction rate for the feasibility of closed loop mitigation control. And with the parameters that I identified for those four outbreaks, the consistent result that you get is that the maximum value of RT is 1.1, or if you manage to compress and reduce the delays in testing as much as possible, you can get as high as 1.2. When this number goes above this, there's no chance this threshold here is exceeded, and you can't really control this in feedback.
Okay. Francesco, just to let you know that 15 minutes have elapsed. Okay, thanks.
So these results are based on linear feedback control theory. Of course, nonlinear controllers could do much better, or time varying could do much better. On the other hand, there's lots of uncertainty on parameters, so you can't use too much sophistication. I think these results give some strong indication on 2 points. One, how difficult the control problem is. And two, most importantly, the crucial role of process measurement and decision delays, which from what I understand, pure time delays, which from what I understand from the literature is not really recognized. So these are the conclusions of the work that I've done so far. I presented a control-oriented model of COVID, which is mostly meant to figure out how well or how by to which extent you can feedback control it. This model can estimate the effect of lockdowns, and it also points out that process decision and measurement delays coupled to unstable trajectories, if you do not have enough social restrictions, plays a key role in the feasibility of mitigation strategies. And particularly, it seems that mitigation strategies, when you have large numbers, can only work if RT is only marginally higher than one. Otherwise, there's no chance it can work. And by the way, this leads me to another research question I would like to work now. And the question is this behavior peculiar of COVID-19? Because apparently nobody bothered about these delays before in the literature. That's what I'm trying to do right now. I conclude with a dedication to two very important persons that were behind this work, and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Francesco, for your very interesting talk. And there is time for a quick question. No. Okay, there are no questions. I just would like then to take the opportunity to formulate my best wishes for your mom's health, knowing this good news that she recovered. So that's a very good news. Okay, so if there are no other questions, I take advantage of this to move forward and try to stay on time and defer even other discussions to the offline coffee break session. And I introduced the last talk, Model Calibration and Robustness Analysis of COVID-19 with Italian Data, Chiara Antonini, Sara Calandrini, Fabrizio Stracci, Claudio Dario, Fortunato Bianconi, and Paolo Valigi.
Okay, yes. Can you see the screen?
Yes, Chiara, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so first of all, this is a joint work between the company ICT4Life, the Department of Engineering and the Department of Experimental Medicine of the University of Perugia and the COVID-19 Epidemiological Unit of the Regional Government of Umbria. The work started from the initial request of the Umbria regional government to have a support for better understanding the evolution of the epidemic and in particular the evolution of the hospitalization rates. So thanks to the available data that we have in real time, many mathematical models have been generated, have been produced in the previous month, and especially deterministic mathematical models are based on the classical SIR model, as we have seen before. So in order to support this request, what we did is the following. First of all, we started from an extended SIR model in order to represent the different stages of the infection of COVID-19. We calibrate the model using a Bayesian methodology called conditional robust calibration. Then we apply on the calibrated model another algorithm called conditional robustness analysis in order to understand the influence of the epidemiological parameter and of the intervention parameter on the hospitalization capacity. This workflow was applied, first of all, to the epidemiological data of the Umbria region and also to the data of Italy, and I will show both results. So first of all, let's take a look at the model. This compartmental epidemiological model was initially developed by Alison Hill at Harvard University. It can be found here in this link. It describes the evolution, the clinical progression of the disease. At the beginning, we have susceptible individuals who enter in contact with uninfected people. So they can become infected and then start out in an exposed class where they do not transmit the virus and do not have symptoms. After a while, they enter the pre-symptomatic class where they can transmit the virus but still do not have symptoms. Then a fraction of these individuals enter the asymptomatic class and then recovers, while the remaining fraction enter the mild infection class where they have mild symptoms. From the M class, people can recover or progress to a more severe infection where they are hospitalized. From the hospitalization, again, people can either recover or enter the intensive care unit. And finally, from intensive care unit, people can recover or die. In the model, we also introduced the possibility of an intervention. Here we have the parameter S0 and S1, which describe the different restrictive measures imposed by the Italian government in order to reduce the transmission of presymptomatic, asymptomatic MRD infections. And then we also introduced the personal protective equipment inside the hospitals. According to the model, we assume that only people in ICU can die and that all people have equal susceptibility to infection. Here we have the ordinary differential equations of the model. We have an equation for each state variable and the intervention parameters here are B0, B1, B2, and B3 are the transmission rate parameters are mitigated through the intervention parameter S0, S1, and S2. Then according to this model, the rate parameters are related to the clinical observation using these formulas here. What we estimate are the parameters on the right part of this formula, such as the presymptomatic period, the duration of the mild infections, and then we compute the rate model parameters. So this is the procedure, the method we used for estimating model parameters. As I said before, it is a Bayesian approach, which considers the parameter vector as a random variable. And it aims at estimating the posterior distribution of the parameter conditioned to the measurement data. In this case, we have the epidemiological data. The first step of this procedure consists in sampling the parameter space to Latin hypercube sampling, starting from an initial prior distribution of the parameter. A fixed number of samples is generated, and through these samples, the ODE model is integrated in order to compute the output variables Y. Then, in the second step, we define a distance function for each output variable, which represents the distance, the difference between the real data and the simulated data. In the third step, we choose a threshold for each output variable, which is the maximum accepted level of agreement between measured and simulated data. By selecting those distance function under the defined threshold, we automatically define a set in the parameter space, those parameters that determine value of the distance function under the threshold. In the fourth step, the different sets of parameter samples obtained in the previous step are intersected among each other in order to obtain a single portion of the parameter space which complies all the different thresholds defined before. And from this set of samples, we can estimate the an approximation of the posterior distribution of the parameter vector. We can estimate the probability density function of parameters conditioned to the fact that the distance functions are under the chosen threshold. And to do that, we use a kernel density approach. This procedure is iterative and can be repeated in multiple steps every time shrinking the initial proposed distribution of the parameter perturbation until the desired level of agreement between the observed data and simulated data is reached. And the output variable is the approximate probability density function for the parameter vector. Once the model is calibrated, we then apply to the model another algorithm, the conditional robustness analysis algorithm. First of all, we start from the definition of robustness proposed by Kitano, which defines the robustness as a system's characteristic of maintaining one or more of its functions under internal or external perturbations. The method, the CRA method that we use to study robustness was initially developed in the field of cancer systems biology to study ODE models representing cancer interaction networks responsible of the cell proliferation activity. In that case, the goal is to disrupt the robustness of the cell in order to reduce its proliferation. And through the CRA, it is possible to study the influence of the model parameters on a variable of interest. In that case, it was a protein responsible of the proliferation activity. In this case, we have the hospitalization capacity. The output of this algorithm of the CRA is an index for each model parameter, which is called the Moment Independent Robustness Indicator, MIRI. And the higher is the value of the MIRI, the higher is the impact of the parameter on the selected output variable. So now let's see the results of these two methods applied to both the Italian and the Umbria case. First of all, here we have the results of the model calibration applied to Italy. We use the data of the Italian Civil Protection Department. We calibrate the model using the data from the 24th of February to the 3rd of May. And we calibrate against three variables, hospitalized, ICU, and dead, because we suppose that the number of mild infections is underestimated. Here the figure shows the result of the calibration. We have the time behavior is shown in logarithmic scale. We can see that the calibration achieves consistent results for all three variables, H, ICU, and D, while there is a shift between the number of mild infections observed and those predicted by the model. And this confirms the fact that people were tested many days after the onset of the first symptoms, especially during the most critical phase of the pandemic, as confirmed also by the data of the Istituto Superiore di Sanità. Here on the right, there is the results of the model calibration for some parameter values. We have the different transmission rate. We can see that the presymptomatic rate is higher compared to the other transmission rate, while then the incubation period is estimated at around 5 days as expected, and the fraction of asymptomatic people is estimated at about 31% of the total infections. We have a similar results for the Umbria example. Again, we use the data of the Italian Civil Protection Department, this time from the 3rd of March, since in the region the epidemic started some days later compared to other Italian region. Again, we have similar results. We can see that the calibration is consistent for H, ICU, and D, and that there is the same shift for the mild infections. The transmission rate of presymptomatic, again, is higher compared to the other parameters, and the value of the other parameters are similar to the Italian case. This time, we also had the possibility to compare the model results with the data of the Istituto Superiore di Sanità. Here, there is the comparison. On the left, we have the epidemic curve estimated by the model in light blue and the observed data of the Italian Civil Protection Department. We have the number of new positive cases every day, normalized against the population of Umbria. While on the right, we have the epidemic curve estimated by the Istituto Superiore di Sanità. In light blue, we have the date of symptom onset, and in violet, the date of sample. So in both figures, we can see that the peak is shift on the left. But there is a difference because the model estimates a higher number of new positive cases compared to those to the curve on the right. And this confirms the fact that the testing capacity of the Umbria region was not always able to increase as the epidemic spread at the same rate as the epidemic spread. So if the model is correctly specified, probably the difference between the observed and the model-based incidence of infections represent the number of reported cases. Now let's see the results of the conditional robustness analysis applied to Italy and Umbria. Here, to run the robustness analysis, we used a MATLAB software called the CRA Toolbox. We wanted to analyze the hospitalization capacity, so we evaluated the area under the curve of the hospitalized in the model. We ran two different temporal scenarios. The first one until May, until we did the calibration, and the second one until September. And in this case, we introduced more intervention parameters in order to take into account the progressive lockdown release implemented by the Italian government after the beginning of May. Both figures show the output of the CRAD and MIRI values for the different model parameters. Here we have box plot because we run 10 independent realizations of the algorithm. So each box plot shows the 10 different realizations. We can see for the first scenario that parameters with the highest MIRI are Bikoni and the presymptomatic period, meaning that this transmission plays a crucial role in the diffusion of the contagion. And while the presymptomatic period, of course, cannot be controlled, Bikoni can be mitigated through either a hygiene standard, face mask, and social distancing, as we know. While in the second scenario, we can see that the latest intervention parameters has a MIRI around 2, meaning that also, as we can see now, the social restrictions are determinant in the evolution of the epidemic. So given the results of this second scenario, we tried to make some predictions by varying the strength of the...
Chiara, you are now using the question time.
Okay.
There are 4 minutes total left, including questions. Thanks. Okay.
So here we made some prediction of the 3rd of May varying the intervention parameters. Here we can see on the left the case of a strong intervention and on the right the opposite case where of a weak intervention where the lockdown measures are almost completely lifted. Here in the center, we have the intermediate intervention case, which seems to be the one most close to the reality, to what is currently happening. Here, indeed, we show the time behavior of H and SU variables in comparison with the data. And the data in red are those not used for calibration, so from the 4th of May until the end of August. And we can see that it pretty much follows the behavior of the model. And finally, here we have the results of the robustness applied to the Umbria region. Results are similar to those of Italy, but there is a difference, which is the MIRI of this parameter, the first intervention parameter SO1. And this probably means that in Umbria, the first restriction measures taken by the Italian government have been more determinant in reducing in the spread of the infections because in our region, the contagion started some days later compared to other Italian regions. So this highlights the importance of the lockdown timeliness. So to conclude, possible future work, of course, would be to calibrate the model using also the data of this new phase of the data of the summer and to analyze separately each Italian region, since the Italian health system is very decentralized, and it would be possible also to introduce mobility data of age classes in order to have more reliable predictions. So I'm done, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Chiara. So we have time for a quick question. We have a couple of minutes, like 2 minutes. Okay, so I don't see any question. So we can meet, we can just wrap up the session and meet for the virtual coffee break where maybe people want to ask questions with more time and with no rush. So just to wrap up, I have a couple of messages from the organization. There is a virtual coffee break for 15 minutes where you can join any of the piazza for an informal chat and stay together. In this same room at 5:30, we're going to have the roundtable on the remote teaching. Other than that, this was a very numerous and attended session for which I thank you, everyone. I'm very happy that the community reacted to the pandemic with its expertise and knowledge to try to give answers and try to contribute. And I thank you very much for participating, contributing, and attending. And I hope to see you around in person as very soon as possible. Okay, so it's a wrap. 5:10, we are on time. Enjoy your coffee and see you around, hopefully, not anymore virtually.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thanks.
Thank you.